How many of us maintain servers, like for personal use or anything? Servers, yeah? So if you SSH into a server, what next? Where's your VS Code now? So today we're going to be talking about effective terminal session management. Now, you should basically go away with feeling wow. So like, you know, you use the terminal for everything. Huh? Such hacker, much wow. Thank you. Who's myself? I gave my introduction. I also act as the resident permissions overlord. You can ask anybody at DeepSource sitting right next to you that if they need something approved, it goes through me first. Gives me a lot of semblance of power. I know. Let's get everybody on the same page. Yes, everybody uses VS Code. Yes, it's written in Electron, so it's designed to be slow. Yes, with every new folder, you have to make a new window. And yes, I'm biased against it, partly because everybody uses it. There's nothing fancy about it. And for any good reason, if you use a full-blown IDE, Raghav, I'm looking at you. You have my condolences. That's it. That's the talk, guys. Thank you so much for coming. All right, fine. It's not all bad, okay? So VS Code is easy to configure. It has a lot of extensions. It can be turned into a pseudo IDE of sorts. It's open source. It's simple yet very powerful. And it's a GUI, you know, so everybody likes it. Show of hands, how many of us have started from a Git GUI? Committing things to Git with a GUI? Yeah, nice, okay. Lot of terminal folks here, nice. So why go to the terminal then? So like every impoverished, broke undergraduate student has started with our VS Code, you know, to finish your projects that you copied off of GitHub from other people so that you pass and meet your deadlines. But I ran into a bunch of problems when I was rising around with things. So if you SSH into a server, how many of us maintain servers, like for personal use or anything? Servers, yeah? So if you SSH into a server, what next? Where's your VS Code now? No? You have to set it up. If a production machine is breaking, are you going to set up a VS Code extension into it, sir? No, no. If you want to run multiple commands, right? Say you are running a watch command on something. If you want to run a separate command to diagnose something, what are you going to do? You're going to open up a new SSH connection, right? There's no mouse in SSH, all right? Whatever history you have is the history you have. It doesn't ship by default on most Linux distributions, on Mac OS distributions, right? You have to kind of go to whatever garbage way of installing VS Code is. Sorry, I'm biased, but you do it that way. And usually you have to have a... So the way I at least worked was you have your editor on one side, and because you never really used one terminal, you had like multiple terminals running, you just ran something like tmuxinator or something, whatever, terminator on GNOME for that matter, with like multiple terminal windows, because it was just clunky. After a while, it started feeling really boring. Just wanted a change. So where lieth our promised land? So let's get the recipe. Here is the nutrition info. So the prep time depends on how long you can run the :edge command on Vim before you lose your sanity. The servings is for one, because nobody that has written dot files can understand everybody on somebody else's dot files. I can speak from experience. And yield, you get to tell everybody why the setup is garbage. So the ingredients we're going to use are Vim, tmux, and our good old symlinker tool, ln. So the plan of action will be to install Vim, to install tmux, do something, and hopefully profit. Let's look at what Vim plus tmux as a setup looks like. I'll quickly get rid of... this part of the presentation isn't planned. So, we have here item running very simply, right? So what do most people do? You have your window, what are they called? Tiling window managers, right? You use something like i3, you use something like bspwn to spawn multiple, say, tabs and windows and terminals. What you can do instead is run something called tmux. Now, tmux is a very unassuming piece of program, because what you can do is you can start a new server, let's say meetup, and doesn't seem like much has changed, right? But what you've just gotten is a full desktop environment, as I like to call it, on your terminal. Why? So let's give you an analogy. So say you're running macOS, right? You want to have different sessions. What will you do? There's some place here where you go like, this is my name, right? I'm running as a separate user. This is my session. What you have in tmux is you have sessions.
Oh, I can also run keycaster.
Keycaster is just a small utility which will let you see what keys I'm pressing, just for some context, because that's required. So tmux uses something called tmux uses something called a mod for mod key. Mine is set to tilde. So what I do is, if I do this, I can spawn new sessions. So I can spawn a new session with say dot files, and they are now simultaneously being maintained. So these are two completely separate sessions running with two different things. Say we can have we can go into the slides here, which is in dot meetup, and we can run the slides here. So the slides are running here. We can go here, and then we have a separate session with dot files, and you can seamlessly change between the two anytime you want, right? Say you're in dot files, you want to have multiple windows. What this allows you to do, right? You're creating multiple windows here. Hey, this is clunky, right? You have to use your mouse, you have to move your hands away from your keyboard back to your mouse. What you can do here is just click your mod key and press N, a C, and that will create a new window. So if we run an LL here, say, and we have a separate window here which is running, say, something like get pods, Kubernetes. Say, you have different windows here, which will be represented by different desktops on macOS, say. Now, what you also have is also your standard splitting. You can split it into any number of things you want. I don't have NeoFetch, I don't get to be cool, but it's fine. That's the base idea behind it. Now you have so you get the idea, right? I'm running a full desktop environment of sorts inside a single terminal. You don't need to spawn multiple different terminals. You don't need to manage an alt tab between all of them. You just go to the whatever session you have, you spawn however many things you want, and you just navigate between them. Why do this? Right, that's a good question. Anybody see any advantage to why you'd like to do this?
No.
Any show of hands? No, no, no. Why would I do this instead of just using VS Code like everybody else? Because it's seamless, right? Because you don't have to switch context every time. With say something like VS Code, right? You have to alt tab. Now, these are small nitpicks that you might think of, key. It's fine, right? I have to just alt tab and find the right VS Code window, right? But it breaks context, and it breaks the ease with which you're able to interact with multiple things. Now that we have, at least this solves the SSH problem for that matter as well. You can tmux and vim ship by default on most distributions. You can just pin up tmux and boom, you have the same setup with just a different mod key. There it is control B instead of tilde, which I have set up. But now you have the ability to run multiple windows, multiple commands, multiple sessions in any desktop or on any server you want. Now what you do is you pair it up with something like vim. I'm gonna just decrease the magnification a little because I can't see it properly on my screen. But what vim allows you to do, at least, let's go to the dot files, my dot files repo. And now you have a full editor plus desktop environment to work from. Right, what you can do is you can open up your various configuration files that you have. You can work on them simultaneously. If you're working on a Go project, you can just run go run, vim.go, let it compile there, and there's seamlessness to everything. Right? That's what makes the whole thing work, at least for me. What? How many of us can touch type? Touch typing is basically without looking.
Right?
Once you get used to using the HJKL keys by default, the home row becomes really nice to use. So that's the basic idea behind using vim and tmux together. Now there's a lot of blog posts where people have configured it to however they want it to work, but the general idea will always be the same, is that you don't need to switch between. The terminal is the way you interact with your system. You shouldn't need to switch to 20 different applications just to develop things. You should ideally be able to do all your development work here, because that's the way Unix was designed to be. If you set up something like OpenSUSE, you're going to be greeted with a terminal. You're not going to be greeted with a GUI environment. And after a while, this just is a faster way of moving around with things. Now, so how many of us use Vim? Like, just know how their way around Vim, the basics of Vim. A lot of us, right? If once you get used to Vim, what makes Vim attractive? What makes Vim attractive is the fact that it's built from the ground up, keeping in mind navigation as the primary, first deliverable. Vim really has, when you have different command modes that allow you to navigate quickly between things, like it gives you a lot of control and speed over how you interact with everything on your terminal. So, if you're used to Vim, like a lot of times you'll want to use Vim bindings everywhere because it's just faster that way. So, to those who don't use it, let's show you Vimium C. So Vimium C is just a, let's go to comms, whatever. So you see how I am not using my mouse to navigate the browser. I'm just pressing D to go down, U to go up. Searching is Wikimedia. And if I want to select the whole sentence, I just press Shift V, press Yank, and I can paste it. You don't need to touch your mouse at all. And it might seem like a small nitpick, right? It just takes a small motion to go from your home key back to your mouse key. But it really makes a difference if you're able to do all of this seamlessly directly between your terminals. You just alt up between things and then just use the same key bindings to move around, whatever. So that's at least what's worked for me in the long run for the last few years now. This has been a very comfortable way of working in general with anything that I've been thrown into. So let's give you a quick demo of what the actual dot files look like. So for tmux, it's pretty simple. I just have a alias set for tmux. Don't get intimidated by any of the configs. One of the lightning talks is going to talk about how to manage your dot files in Git. But what I'd recommend, just as a hack, if you're looking to manage dot files, is just to use simple symlinks, if you're aware of what they are, because a symlink farmer like Stow is unnecessary to do these things. So let's go to dot files. This is what my dot files look like. Don't worry, it wasn't that clean about a year ago. It looked like an absolute mess. Takes some time to get used to. So since it's common configs, nvim configs are a neo, the editor is neovim. So since they're common, they just stay here and they're maintained in Lua. So you have your init.lua, which will have your standard required settings. And then you can configure it however you want. Any questions so far, like about the whole setup, why you do this? No? No questions? Come on guys, it's no need to be shy. No? No questions? Why not use Emacs? I have a question. Why not use Emacs? Because it's a lifestyle that I don't want to have in my life. That's why. So how can you get started if you don't know any of these tools? You can get started very simply if you want to get used to it. You know, Vim has this whole... Vim is too difficult with a very high learning curve. It's all garbage. There's Vim Tutor that will teach you how to use Vim. You can just literally follow through along with whatever they teach you, read the documentation properly, and you'll get used to moving around with Vim. A quick hack, if you don't want to get a pinky that's longer than your middle and ring fingers, is just to set the caps lock key as your escape key. I don't have a caps lock key. If you use caps lock, say goodbye to it. You don't need to type that many caps lock sentences. No, don't be angry at so many people. So just set the caps lock key to escape, because it's just easier that way. So if you want to say have a Vim config to get started, this is a good place to go because Vim config can look pretty intimidating once it's there. So I can open up mine quickly to show you, because it doesn't look the best there. So say this is the config. Like, there's a lot of options that might not make sense, and that's the bane of configuring Vim. At least it's become better now that Vim has moved from 0.5 to Lua. But it doesn't make sense. So the first thing that I'd recommend you get used to is just the help command. So let's go to the dot files. So say you want to, let's figure out what an option does. So say you didn't know anything about what fold level start means. So right, Vim has you can look for help within Vim. So what you can do is press command H, and then it's being written on the bottom left. You can't see because it's there. Here, I'll just move it here so that stays there. So you just do that, and Vim will give you a nice documentation of what it all means and how to set it. So it's more work, than going into something like VS Code settings and then just kind of reading what it's about. But at least for me, it's more fun this way because I don't know, it just feels that way. I don't know what about it exactly makes it more fun. But yeah, you can just go figuring out what all these are. But yeah, the whole setup can look pretty intimidating if you're just looking at it for the first time. It's like, what are all these plugins? What is this script? How am I gonna do this? I don't wanna do this, let's just use VS Code. So the better idea is to go to something like this, which is vimconfig.com. You can just take simple things that you want to show in Vim, check them, and then it'll give you a generated WebRC that you can directly use. So what do I mean by a WebRC? So you remember we started talking about dot files, right? So dot files are, the reason why they're called dot files is if we go to our home folder, we don't see any special dot files except for the folder that is here. Where is the dot files folder? Here, that's my folder. But most Unix systems, if you just do a ls-a, you see a lot of dot files, right? Dot files are where the configuration files are stored. It is opinionated for a lot of people where they decide to store their own dot files, but generally with programs like NeoVim and tmux, you're gonna find the dot files in config. So you go to config and you see multiple different dot files. Now if you do a ls-la on NeoVim, you see that this is symlinked to the dot files folder that I have on my home folder. And yeah, so you go to NeoVim and you'll find the same set of things there. So when Vim starts, it basically is looking for a config file in a default location. And that default location is set to .config/nvim with the init.lua file. So if it's there, that is where it will pull the configuration from. That's the general idea behind these dot files, right? So once you have a basic dot file here, a basic WebRC here, you can start playing around with the capabilities of Vim. Vim by default is pretty bare bones. I'll give you an example of what that is. Let's SSH into one of my servers and let's just open Vim. That's all that Vim has. Like, let's open up an Excel file. Not those. Let's open up now. See, like it doesn't have it barely looks like you have a text editor open, right? So by default, it doesn't ship with a lot of features, but you can really customize it to say, have a full, you can have a full IDE running for that matter in it. With this main dot, where it will do syntax completion for you, it will load all the packages for you, everything for that matter. Like if I think I remove this, it will show me an error message as well. So like to get here, right, this isn't going to get you here. What you need is plugins. So you can go to something like vimawesome.com where you'll be able to find the most commonly popular and available plugins. And what do you usually use to install plugins on, say, Ubuntu? Like, what's the sudo? Come on, yes, apt get install, right? So what do you do here? How do you install a plugin on Vim? Show of hands. How? You can use a plugin manager. There's a bunch of different plugin managers. I use Pack. So Pack will do installs for you. You can configure all of this again in the dot file itself. There's
you can go to nvim-vaq,
and this will give you the detailed documentation of how you want to set it up in your own dot file. Once you have a plugin manager like Pack, you can just give it a list of plugins you want to install. So what that would look like is, so for me, plugins are stored under list. So we have a list of just plugins that I want to install that Pack will install for me. And there's a bunch of plugins that you can use. The Epoch will be your father if you want to look for Vim plugins that are perfect and everybody makes use of. But the ones I can recommend are Surround is good. Vim Git Gutter is necessary. Nerd Commenter is fine. But you can just go and play around with these. So once you have your plugins, you're basically good to go with Vim at least. Now let's get talking with tmux. So with tmux, there's no exaggerated changes that you have to make for that matter. I can show you because. So let's go to. So there's a file here. There's a file here called .tmux.con. What we can do, this is what tmux is using to source the changes. What we can do is just to prove that you don't need a configuration file to use tmux, you can get rid of it entirely. Let's exit out here. It won't look the prettiest. We can kill the tmux server. And let's start a new server. And that is what tmux will look like by default. Not the greatest, but it still works just the same way. Like all the changes that I've made are just syntactic sugar that you can make have it to look nicer. But all you really need is just tmux and a cheat sheet. So you can find a tmux cheat sheet just by looking for it. And this will tell you everything that you need to know about tmux basically. Then if tmux has a horrible mod key, control B. You see this? I'm having to press this combination every time I have to make, say, a change. Control B Z, right? You can change it to be a single key so that you don't have to unnecessarily press this all times.
Hey folks, Vishesh here from the future with the power of editing. We ran into some technical difficulties, that's why the video got cut short, but don't worry, you didn't miss out on much. DeepSource hosts these events every now and then. Check us out on Twitter if you want to stay in the loop.